Hello everyone, I am Khushbu Natholia and thank you for coming back to my channel. Well, just imagine if I ask you to find a judgment for me. What will you do? I guess a lot many of you are simply gonna go to Google and search the judgment. Or a few of you may, if you have a software such as Manupatra or other softwares being used, you may use them. But I think it might be at least negligent number of people who are actually gonna go to library and search it out for me. So what exactly I want to say is that how important is technology today for us? How important is it to be familiar with the technologies? So today we will discuss about technology in Indian judiciary. We will talk about virtual courts. Well, ever since this COVID-19 came into picture, there are two things which we often hear related to judiciary. The first is the role of video conferencing in the justice delivery system, and the second is the importance of e-filing. But I wonder, how can we actually come to this point? Because there are a lot of things behind the scene which are required to be done, such as planning, training, then you need investments for it. So I don't think that it is a one-day process that, okay, fine, since the court are shut, you cannot have physical appearance bearing to the spread of COVID-19 coronavirus, and you suddenly think that, okay, fine, we cannot suspend the judiciary because it is going to increase the pendency, and judiciary cannot be suspended in any way because the rights of the people are being governed by it and it will be at stake. So, how do we come to this video conferencing idea? I'm going to talk about the evolution of this use of technology which has helped us to come to this video conferencing idea today. And I'm going to start from back 1970 when NIC, that's the National Informatics Center, they came up with the idea and with the process of computerization of the Indian courts. There has been a lot many policies projects such as the CORTIS, which is related to the everyday activities of filing of the cases and generating of cause list. Then you have the JUDIS, which helps you to get the judgments, the reportable judgments, copies available online. So all these technologies helped us to come to this conclusion, that is the present situation we are in. If I talk about the district courts, then the process of digitalization of this district court began in 1977. The 1970 which I talked about digitalization, that was for the apex court and the high court. And on the same line, the digitalization of the Supreme Court came into picture. The first attempt actually to digitalize district court was a failure, but obviously you learn from your mistakes. So you came up with the second idea, with the second attempt to digitalize district court, and that attempt was divided into two stages. The first stage covered the district courts in the four metropolitan areas, and the second stage covered the district courts situated in the other jurisdiction which have high court associated to them. And it covered around 900 courts, district courts in the second phase. So this is how actually the district court computerization came into picture. The first phase was in the 2001 and 2002. And the second phase was actually in 2003 to 2004. Moving on, then after the process of digitalization, the 2005 conference actually can be termed as a source of actual digitalization and a boon to the technology in the justice delivery system, because that was the conference wherein the idea of e-filing and video conferences were brought into picture. And then there was this e-committee which was formed, which came up with strategic plans which were divided into three phases. The first phase, which began from February 2007 and went up till March 2015, that dealt with installing the ICT applications or technology in all the courts. It covered the, you know, the starting from the minimum requirement of providing laptops to generating softwares and then providing training facilities and so on. So the basics started from them. The second phase came into picture, which started from August 2015 and it, you know, continued till 2019. And the aim was of setting up a centralized filing system, digitalization of the documents and adaptation to the ICT technology so that with a single click, you can get the desired data. And then finally, we entered the third phase, the phase which we are currently in, and it covered all the ICT coverage from the judicial process for filing up till the execution and all administrative activities associated. So this is how we entered into a phase wherein the video conferencing and e-filing actually came into picture. Now, talking about it, we know that today, judiciary is able to deliver not many judgments because of this video conferencing technique, even after not being able to operate from the court. For example, just imagine the situation of the class 10th and 12th board examination students whose exams were cancelled, whose exams were, you know, asked to be taken by the CBSE, and they were in a state of complete confusion and the health of the students were at stake. And that's when the judiciary came into picture and asked CBSE to give guidelines and to give further guidelines to evaluate the examinations and postpone the examination, keeping in consideration the health of the students. So what would have happened, just imagine, if it was not there, then the plea of the migrants, you know, who face so many difficulties, what would have happened to them if the judiciary was not there? Because it is not feasible at all that the judiciary shut down because of any pandemic, because the rights of the people cannot be at stake. And technology helped to gain this situation, to help people come out and address their problems in this situation. But as a coin has two faces, similarly, this technology also has two faces. If I talk about the advantages of technology, then I must say that, you know, if I list SMS system, you know, there is an SMS system wherein the advocate whose name in the Vakalatnama, they get an SMS of update with respect to the case laws, right? So it helps the advocate, it save money and save time from traveling and getting updates about their cases. Similarly, this one click which helps you to check your updates, to check your status, to check the cause list, even to find the judgments and orders available online, helps a lot many money and time which might be used in getting it if you have to physically go to the court and check it. Because if you know, then if you have to see the order from the case file, you first need to move an application and then you need to go and check the file. It is very time consuming. So it helps you to save that time. Then it is always obviously very environment friendly because the paperwork is reduced and so on and so forth. There are n number of things like the display board system which is there. It helps you to be updated with which matter is being taken up and when is your matter coming, so that if you have two or three cases, you can, you know, actually decide as to how to balance your time. So this is how the judiciary has helped. But at the same time, it has a lot many disadvantages also. For example, just imagine if there is a cross-examination going on, or if there is a cross-examination going on, if you have your client nearby, it is easier to communicate and get their trust and get their confidence, give that confidence to the client. But when it is related to technology, that physical absence of physical presence creates a lot of hurdle. It might lead the client to be a bit, you know, underconfident, and he may lose his, he may not be able to deal with the situation. He may be feeling a bit nervous or, you know, things like that. Similarly, on the other hand, when you talk about internet and accessibility of internet, we need at least a smartphone or a laptop or something like that to access. But in India, we know that there is a large population who is uneducated, who do not have smartphones, who are technologically not that well versed. So it is difficult for them. It is difficult for them to cope up with this situation. So this situation need a lot of awareness as of now and a lot of education for the people to be able to actually use it in the manner in which it is supposed to be used. Moving on then, if we have to take testimonies, right, expert guidance and things like that, it may be helpful because it will save the time of the people to come to the court and then, you know, provide evidence. But on the same hand, the it has a drawback that you are not able to probably at times connect due to the slow server. For example, if I give you my today's example, I had to present a paper in a seminar, but because of the internet issues and then not able to display my PPT on the screen, there was a lot of confusion. So all these things need a lot of I would have recommended if they would have given me a demo session, but they did not. So I had no option but to just speak as extempo. So all these things, they need time, they need education, they need that people should be aware as to how the technology is to be used so that it is used in the way it should be. So that is what the advantages and disadvantages are. Moving on, apart from this, I would like to conclude by saying that technology is good. Technology helps you in a lot many ways, like I have already said. But at the same time, actually emphasizing on virtual court is probably not the only need of the hour. We should be more focused on developing the digitalization of the court. For example, we have come up till e-filing. We can move ahead and we can, you know, give the option of filing your rejoinders, your applications and everything online. This is going to save a lot of time. This is going to save a lot of paper and this is going to save a lot of money also. So similarly, digitalization and then taking baby steps obviously will help us to reach to a goal. And also completely being dependent on virtual court cannot be the scenario because there is a particular limit to it. You cannot address as many cases which you can do while you are there physically in the court because there is a limit. There are n number of other things which need to be taken into consideration. Yes, it is good for the time being to address the immediate problems, but that cannot take place of a physical court. So the main emphasis should be digitalizing it a bit more so that we can, you know, use the technology in the way in which it is supposed to be, and probably we will come to a scenario wherein this video conferencing and everything will actually be a cakewalk for us. Thank you so much, and I would like to hear suggestions and if any from you in the comment section, because so that even I can enhance my knowledge on the subject, since this is the first video I'm making on a topic which is recent. So I would love to hear suggestions from you guys. Looking forward for your suggestions, and if you have any question, do put them in the comment box. I will try and remove your queries there itself. Thank you so much for listening to me, and I hope to see you in the next video soon. Bye bye.